Jeremiah, if you have your Bibles, want to turn with me today. Say this while I'm getting ready, while you're getting ready. If I'm not ready, we're in trouble. While you're getting ready, Jeremiah chapter 18. I want to say this. Really appreciate all you moms and dads. I thought about Caleb's done gave me a workout this morning. You know, he's trying to get my microphone, trying to get what hair I got left, trying to get the tree. I think he wanted in that big bathtub back there. So, anyways, I've thought a lot about Ashley. She brings those kids. Little doc. Yeah, she brings those kids and plays our piano. And she was worried, I guess, about who was going to take care of Caleb when he got ready to walk. I thought to myself, that's going to be all right. Devin's going to start coming, and your mom's going to join, and everything's going to be great. So, anyways, I appreciate you moms and dads bringing your kids to church. Amen. It's wonderful for a mom or a dad or for a mom and dad to attempt and to make the effort to raise their kids in church. I don't know anything any better, any greater that you could possibly do for your children than to try your best to raise them in church. My mom did it for me. I thought a lot about it. You know, I don't know if I would be where I'm at today. Probably not. I probably wouldn't be standing here and you probably wouldn't be listening to me. If my mama hadn't raised me in church the way she did. Now, God could have still called me to preach. God could have still used me. But who knows if I'd even be a believer yet if my mom had not put that effort and instilled some things in me. So I appreciate you bringing your kids to church. And I guess sometimes they're loud. Sometimes they're rowdy. And what are kids supposed to do? Are they not supposed to be loud? Are they not supposed to be rowdy? So that's the way it's supposed to be, LC says. So, I appreciate you bringing them, and good part about it is, before I read this, you bring them to church when they're little, they'll be like these big kids over here. They'll come when they're big. So raise your kids in church, and I appreciate all the effort. I know it's not easy sometimes, so I appreciate that. But more than me appreciating it, you know, God appreciates that. God, it pleases God when you bring your children to church. I really believe that. So got your Bibles, 18th chapter of the book of Jeremiah. It does take a village to raise children. Right here's our village. So let us help you raise your kids. Bring them. We'll worry about the rest later. So 18th chapter of the book of Jeremiah. I've already said it's a tough crowd. I want y'all to listen this morning. Something God has gave me to, it encouraged me when God gave me this message. So hopefully it'll encourage you today. I know lately I've been preaching with a lot of meat. Been feeding you all meat, and you know, God said, give them a little bit of pudding today. So everybody likes pudding, right? Something sweet, and everybody likes chocolate, right? So this is chocolate pudding. Everybody smile. Let's get into it. Chapter 18, it says, the word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, arise and go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause thee to hear my words. Then I went down to the potter's house, and behold, he wrought a work on the wheels, and the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. So he made it again another vessel, as it seemed good to the potter to make. Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, O house of Israel, cannot I do with you as this potter, saith the Lord? Behold, as the clay is in the potter's hands, so are ye in mine, O house of Israel. That's all I want to read this morning. You be much in prayer. I thought a lot about this scripture, and I probably used it maybe different times and pieces and one thing and another. But I want you all to realize something today. This was a difficult time in the Bible. You Bible readers know Jeremiah was a prophet that Jeremiah didn't beat around the bush about things. He didn't sugarcoat things. He pretty much just told it the way God gave him. He wasn't elegant in words, and no doubt he probably upset people at times. But this was a big time in the Bible. The children of Israel were under captivity. And so God sent this prophet by the name of Jeremiah to go down to this potter's place where he was making some vessels. And he did that to give Jeremiah a message of encouragement for the people that were in captivity. Now, I want you all to realize something today. There's a lot of people in captivity today. And if you're one of them today, you don't have to stay there. You can be free in Jesus today. You can be free today in God. And so I've been there before. You all remember the story in the Bible about the man named Jonah. You learned that when you was a little bitty kid, right? The Bible teaches us that God commanded Jonah to do one thing, and so Jonah decided he would do a different thing. And so therefore, God loved Jonah so much that the Bible said that he created this big fish, and it swallowed Jonah. Now, I don't know about you, but I've been in the fish's belly before. Has anybody ever been in the whale's belly before? And the Bible said that Jonah made the comment, "Out of the belly of hell cried I." And so I go on to say this. There's a lot of people today, God's people today, that are living in bondage today and are living in captivity today. And it's all because we choose to do one thing when God wants us to do another. Amen. I don't know if you've ever been there before, but if you live long enough, you will be there. So I found myself there before. The children of Israel found themselves there. The good thing about God is, God never leaves you and I. And that means that, Keith, that there's nothing. David said if he soared with the eagles, or if he made his home in hell, that made his bed in hell, that God was there. So God's with us. It doesn't matter if we're at the foot of the cross, or it doesn't matter if we're a million miles away. We can never get away from God. Once you get saved by God's marvelous grace, therefore you belong to God. So folks, I want you all to realize something tonight. Today, God is still working on me, and he's still working on you. And at times in life, I thought about the potter. Do you know what the potter, you know what his intent is? The potter's intent is to take some clay and to make vessels out of it. That's his forte. That's his job. That's what he does. Now, God is a lot in the same way. God's intent is to take some clay. Now, I'm going to bust some of your bubbles real quick. Whether you realize it or not, you and I are nothing but a lump of clay. The Bible says that God took clay and that he formed you and I, and he made us, and so that was in the beginning. And so when God did that, that's what our flesh is made out of. The Bible teaches us that from dust we were created, and that dust we're going to return. So whether you realize it or not, you're a bunch of dirt today. Everybody like that. Does that make you feel better about yourself today to realize that your pastor, your preacher just said you're a bunch of dirt today? Well, if you're dirt, then I'm dirt. Did that make you feel any better? So listen, the Bible teaches us that after that God breathed into the nostrils of Adam the breath of life, and that man became a living soul. So I want you to think about this morning. You and I, without God, are nothing today. Without God, I'm just a lump of clay. And without God, you're just a lump of clay. And there's a big difference today, and I see it in God's people all the time. Do you realize there's a major difference in living and just existing today? Unfortunately, today, many of God's people are just barely getting by. We're just existing. But God wants us to be thriving, and God wants us to be living, and God wants us to be. You read about in 2 Peter, you read about some lively stones that are put together that form a great thing. And so God wants us to be something that's alive. God wants us to be something that's real. God wants us to be something that's exciting. God wants you to thrive today in a society, in a culture that seems to be godless. Do you all recognize that? Do you agree with me that culture seems to be godless today? You look out today and you see so many bad things going on, but thanks be to God that you and I, we're different today. Why? Because God is still working on you and I today.
Send Jeremiah down to the potter's house.
I want you to realize something today. The potter starts with something, Keith, that is less than desirable, if I can use that word. Every vessel that the potter makes into something great, I'm talking about every single one of you all sitting in the congregation today. Whether you realize it or not, you're a vessel for God today. Now, I thought about the potter and what his intent is and what he wants to do with us, but he starts with something that's got so many flaws in it. You're looking at a man today that has many, many flaws. Do you all realize, somebody say amen. Preacher, I know that you're rotten, you're dirty, you're sorry, you're low down. Yeah, but I'm still your pastor. How does that sound? So I started, you know, when God started with me, this is the thing about it. I was saved at a young age, and it doesn't matter what age you're saved at. When God saves you at that point in time, you belong to Him, and you're His child, and God wants to make something out of you. God wants to use every single one of you all today. It doesn't matter if you're big, doesn't matter if you're little, doesn't matter if you think you're a saint or if you think you're a sinner. God still wants to use you today. I thought about, as I was getting ready for this message today, you and I look at people in society much different than God looks at people. My view and God's view are totally different. We see people that live in nice homes. We see people that drive nice vehicles. We see people that have all kinds of these possessions, and we think, man, they're really doing good. Man, they're really wealthy. Man, they're really valuable. But the good news is today that when God saves you at that point in time, you become valuable to God. Do you realize that when you become a child of God, how many people are saved today in this car? When you become a child of God at that point in time, Satan may tell you you're nothing. The world may tell you you're nothing. But at that point in time, God sees value in you. Amen. Aren't you glad today that when God sees you, He sees the blood? And Jesus is sitting at the right hand of God. And guess what? The Bible said He's our advocate. That means that when we sin, when we come short, that Christ is right there and He's our defense. And He says, you know what? Dad, they belong to us. I'm glad I belong to God today. And I'm glad that He's still working on me today. And this was a message of encouragement to Jeremiah, even though the children of Israel had set up idols. How many people in the congregation today? I'm working on a message that I'm going to preach for long, and it's going to be the one that probably breaks the camel's back. I don't know. But do you realize that we've got idols in our lives? Do you realize that it doesn't matter who you are? I promise you've got idols in your life. You've got things that you spend more time on, you spend more money on, you spend more effort on versus God. And that's an idol. That's the only way I know to explain it. But it didn't matter that these people had idols. It didn't matter that they were sinful. It didn't matter that they were sorry and they were low down. He said, Jeremiah, tell them, just as the clay is in the potter's hands. First Baptist Church, I'm preaching a message to you today. Even though that we're flaws, even though that we have all our differences, even though we have impurities, we still belong to God, and God's still the potter, and we're still the clay, and God's still working on us today, and God still got a purpose for every one of you. How would you feel today if you thought you didn't have a purpose? There's people in this congregation today, you'll not admit it to me, but you don't feel like you have a purpose. You don't feel like you're needed. You don't feel like you're valuable. But when God sees me and God sees you, God sees potential. Amen. Potential. In other words, God sees. What does potential mean? When it comes to me and God, Ed, God sees what I could become. Amen. And when God sees you, He don't see how much money you've got. He don't see what kind of house you live in. He don't care if you're wearing Tommy Hilfiger or Tommy Hillbilly. He don't care. When God sees you, amen, He sees potential. He sees what you can be through and by Him guiding you, Him molding you, and Him making you. That was the message. Jeremiah, go down there and tell them people. Aren't you glad today that God's patient? Amen. Has God ever been patient, long-suffering with you before? I don't want you to raise your hand, but how many of you all have ever been an alcoholic? How many of you all have ever been divorced? How many of you all have ever neglected your family? How many of you all have ever laid out of church? How many of you all have ever been out of church? How many of you all have ever doubted what God? I thought about Keith through all my life, all the times I doubted God. The man that saved my soul, how many times I have doubted what his abilities are, what he was capable of doing. So we're all guilty, amen? But I'm glad today that God is patient with me, and that I thought about, we mentioned in Sunday school, aren't you glad God gives us a little bit of rope sometimes? And it's not just immediately when we sin, immediately when we say no. How many people's ever told God before in this congregation, you know, go see so-and-so, or I want you to sing, or I need you to do this, or I just want you to go to church, and you laid in the bed. Aren't you glad that when we say no, that God don't say no? When we say no, God still sees the potential that we have in Christ, and He still sees us as one of His, and He's patient with us, and He's long-suffering with us. And greater than that, Keith, guess what else? God knows that it's a process to get me and you to what He wants us to be. Sometimes that process comes along with making mistakes. The potter has got to have control of the clay. If the potter ain't got control, guess what? The clay turns into God knows what. But when the potter can truly have control, Ed, of the clay, let me ask you a question. Has God got control of your life today? Has God in control of your decisions? Is God in control of your resources? Is God in control of everything you are today? Is God in control? Is the potter in control of the clay today? That's what I'm asking you today. When that, guess what? When the clay gets tough, or when the clay, have you ever realized how many times in life you and I alter God's plan for us? Huh? Do you realize that my sin and your sin can alter what God wants to do with us? Think about it. What if God wants me to be some great preacher, or to be some great, you know, whatever, and what happens if I had to go out and make a bunch of bad decisions, and so therefore I handicap my witness, I handicap what people think about me? What if you see me out there, you see me drunk, you see me out running up and down the roads, whatever it is, am I going to be very effective from that time forward? I'm always going to have to live with the past, so you and I can alter God's plans He has for us. But aren't you thankful today that He's patient, that He's long-suffering? Sometimes, one good thing about the potter, when we decide we want control, I've been reading and studying about this a little bit. Anybody ever took a whooping from God before? God ever had to beat on you before? When this clay, when the clay gets to where the potter can't do nothing, can God do anything with you today? Are you allowing God to do anything with you this morning? Is God your God? Is He your King? Is He your Lord? Does He get to say what you do? Does He get to say what you spend? Does He get... Y'all don't like this no more. What happened all of a sudden? I'm asking you, is God in control of the clay today? Children of Israel decided they wanted control. They got in captivity. You realize you put yourself where you're at today. If you're miserable this morning, Derek, I was miserable last Sunday. You said we need to be holy, and it made me mad. The Sunday before that, you preached about me having feathers, and I ain't got no claws. You know what I'm trying to say. You're still mad. It's time to let God have control of your life today. That's what He wants. You're not going to be happy till you do it. Amen. The potter, when that clay gets where he can't do nothing with it no more, you know what he does? He takes it off of that wheel. He lays it down on something flat, and he gets a mallet, and he starts beating it. Huh? He starts beating it. You know why he beats it? To get all the imperfections out of it, all them air bubbles, see? That clay gets that air in it. Anybody got any air in them today? I almost said any air heads in the congregation, but I didn't. Anybody got any air, any imperfections in them? You know, God, that vessel, Keith, I'm going to preach about that fire in that kiln in just a minute. But listen, that clay, the potter knows if it's got imperfections in it, he's got to get those beat out. Unfortunately, Ed, in my lifetime, I've been like King Nebuchadnezzar. I've had to learn things the hard way. I've had to eat with the cows, and I've had to have feathers. I've been through all that. And so listen, doesn't matter where you're at right now, God's working on you, and if you'll allow Him, it might be tough and it might be hard, and you might have to grow up, and you I said, grow up. There's men and women today. I'm talking about, oh goodness, grown men and grown women that need to grow up today. Amen. Grown mommies, grown daddies that need to realize this ain't good no more, is it? The Bible said that when I was a man, I put away my childish ways. Amen. It's time to put away some things and realize if God gave you children, you need to be responsible. Amen. If God's, I didn't give one amen in the congregation. God's a beat on you today. Listen to me. The Bible teaches us to train a child up in the way it should go, and when it's old, it won't depart from it. It don't mean he won't be in jail. It don't mean he won't be a heathen. I bring facts in the church every Sunday, and I may have to bail him out of the slammer one day, but I've got news. I'm going to instill some things in him. He will know what's right, and he will know what's wrong, and there ain't nobody can ever erase that. How many people's glad the potter don't give up? He just keeps working. So when that clay and when you and I get to where we don't let God have no control no more, you young people, this is for you. You old people, this is for you. Pastor, this is for you. And when I stub up on God and I don't allow him to have full control, then he has to take me off the well and he has to start beating on me. And the way he beats on me is through his word and it's through other people. Amen? Listen, have you ever got yourself in, I think about that movie, Old Brother. You remember ever, he said, we're in a tight spot. Anybody ever gotten a tight spot before? You know your back's against the wall. Sometimes God allows you and I to get in the fish's belly or to get in whatever kind of mess you want to talk about. Why? Because he's trying to bring us back to him, just like the children of Israel. You read in the Bible, every time the children of Israel decided God was not God no more, they didn't need him no more. How many people don't need God no more? Raise your hand. There ain't nobody in the congregation will agree with me on that. But listen, when you decide you're your own person, your own man, your own woman, and you're going to make your own decisions, at that point in time, you're saying, God, I don't need you no more. Boy, that got quiet. No wonder so many broken homes. No wonder so many divorces. No wonder. So many people on drugs. So many people on alcohol. When we stub up and we don't need God no more, then guess what? He has to let us get in trouble. Yep. He beats on that clay with that mallet. Got to get all the bubbles out. Ain't it about time we get some of y'all look at me like you're going to kill me. Ain't it about time we get some of the bubbles out of us? There's a reason for that. When that clay, he'll lay it out there and he beat all the bubbles out of it. And Keith, when he gets all the bubbles beat out of it, the main part of my message is today, the potter don't never discard the clay. Amen? He don't never throw it away. He don't never say, I don't need it no more. He don't never say it ain't useful no more. If I was the potter, you know what I'd do in that clay? I'd say, you know what? There's dirt everywhere. I'd just go dig me up some more. That's not the way God is. Aren't you glad he don't just dig up some more? Aren't you glad he continues to work with me and you? Amen. Beats on it. And when he gets done beating on it, then he adds some water. Some of y'all need some water this morning. Amen. What would you give this morning for just a little bit of spirit? Amen. What would you give? How long's it been? This right here will help a lot. How long's it been since you had glory bumps all over your body and you felt the presence of God? Well, preacher, I feel God in me every day. That's not what I'm talking about. There's a difference in living. Listen to me. Living and existing is a huge difference today. If I choose to turn my back on God and choose to wreck my life, I know God's still with me because I believe in eternal salvation. Amen. I believe, y'all don't even amen that. What do y'all believe anymore in this place? I believe once you're saved, you're always saved. I believe in grace. I believe in mercy. And I believe it's time for me and you to get straightened out, amen? And realize that God loves us, that God wants to put some water on you and soften you up and love on you today. Amen. Adds that water to it. He can pick her up and he can start working on it again. Derek, I am going through a hard time. Hey, well, believe it or not, it's not so easy in my life right now. But James, I realize that God is wanting me to be a great vessel. I realize that God is wanting me to be something more than I am. And Keith, I realized that through that process, how many of you all feel like you got pressure on you right now? Doesn't matter if it's at work. I feel some pressure right now. A little bit of tension. Doesn't matter if it's at work. It doesn't matter if it's at home. And some of y'all done looking at that watch. Yeah, is he about done? Aren't you glad that God don't look at his watch when he's fooling with you? And he realizes how, oh, I ain't even going there. When he gets it back on that wheel, here's the silver lining in all this. The potter, when he puts that clay on that wheel, he'll start turning that. If he ever takes his hands off of it, Ed, it'll fall on the floor. Aren't you glad that God never takes his hands off of you and I? God never takes his hands. Keith, it doesn't matter where I go, and it doesn't matter how sorry I get, and it doesn't matter how much sin I have, how many flaws, God still sees potential and sees value in what's on that wheel. Amen. And listen, folks, let me ask you a question. How do you think that we get to the point in our church that we've got deacons and we've got Sunday school teachers and we've got preachers and we've got these women that teach the... How do you think we get to that point? God sees potential in every single one of you all today. You're sitting here thinking, well, you know, I'll never be a teacher at the church. Or, well, I can't sing, or I can't do this and I can't do that. Can't, never, could. Amen? God can do something great in you if you will give him control of your life.
Amen.
How in the world did God put me here? Think about it. Pressure. That potter. As that clay starts getting out of hand, Coney, he'll have to put a little pressure on it. And see, as that wheel spins, if he add pressure in certain areas, Keith, it'll start to shape. You see what I'm saying? When God puts pressure, or when the world puts pressure, or when you go through hard times, some of you are thinking, I'm sinking right now, Derek, and you don't even care. It ain't that I don't care. It's that God is working on you today. Amen? And I'm not going to ask God to quit working on you. Why? Because I want you to reach full potential. Amen?
Amen.
Applies pressure. Anybody feel uncomfortable today? You shouldn't. You're at God's house, right? Every time I feel uncomfortable, it's because I'm growing. Every time I feel uncomfortable, it's because God's working with me. Sometimes God, I don't know why I'm going to come to a close in a minute. I tell you, I already go home 10 minutes ago, but I wasn't done yet. Anybody ever had to start all over? Some of y'all, Coney, I'm glad that the potter, sometimes he has to find a new purpose. Sometimes he has to find a new job. Sometimes he has to find you a new church. I ain't trying to run none of y'all off. I'm trying to get more that's here. Amen? Sometimes God has to do something different with you, something new for you. Maybe it's a career change. Maybe it's a church change. Maybe it's a family change. But sometimes, Keith, God has to do something different with you because you have got hard and stony on him, and maybe the purpose has changed for you, but God's still not finished with you today. That's important. Still got something great he wants to do. Don't matter who you are in this congregation today, you can start all over. Amen. Doesn't matter how many times you've been on drugs, how many times you've been to rehab, how many times you've dried out, or how many times you've been married, God can do something new in you today.
Amen.
The world don't say so, the doctors don't say so, and society don't agree, but I'm telling you through and by the Word of God, he sees potential in you. He sees value in you. It just depends if you're going to give him control or not. Come get your song. I'm coming to a close. Potter applies pressure. And as it starts to form, when he gets done with this vessel, there's one last step. For a true vessel of clay to... When God saved me, he didn't promise a bed of roses. And unfortunately, when I came to be the pastor here, he didn't say, Derek, every Sunday morning somebody's going to be saved and you're going to baptize somebody every week. unfortunately, that wasn't part of the deal. If he didn't give me that deal, what made him think he gave you that deal? It's not a bed of roses, folks. This is why God wants you and I to be strong. What did he tell Joshua? Be strong, be courageous. He wants us. Whether you realize it or not, just because you're a child of God and you go to church don't mean that everybody in the world is going to respect you. They're going to bow down to you. They're never going to disagree with you. Doesn't mean that things are always going to be easy. When the potter gets done with this vessel, he places it in the fire in a kiln. And the reason he does that, he bakes it. And the reason he bakes it is to make it strong. Because James, the potter, realizes that that vessel is going to see the storms. It's going to see rough water. Hey, some of you all today, I don't know what's on your mind. I look at you today and you're thinking about 10 years down the road, I can tell. Who knows what comes tomorrow, much less 10 years from now. But I know where I'm at today. How about you? I'm in God's hands. And it ain't always comfortable, but I want God to make something great out of me. I want that key. I want it so much that I'm willing to sacrifice. I want it so much that even when you all act like you don't want to hear me, I'm just going to keep preaching. And I want it so bad. It's different. I want it so bad. People talk about when they get to heaven, everybody stand. People talk about all these crowns they're going to get in heaven and all these jewels. I have no idea how all that's going to work. I do know this. It doesn't matter how many crowns you get on your head, you're going to throw them down at his feet anyway, according to the Bible. Keith, all I want to do is just have me a little spot over there somewhere. It don't even matter if it's in the corner. But to hear him say, "Well done, my faithful servant. You've been faithful over just a few things. I'll make you ruler over many." Keith, that's all I'm aiming for. Now, I don't know what you're wanting to achieve, but that's all I want. What you need to do this morning, God wants to do something great with you. He sees potential in you through all your failures, all your weakness. You might feel like you're in the fire this morning, but he's just trying to make you stronger. While we sing, would you come to this altar?
Page 165 in the red book.